Welcome to the first ever UCLA Law Women Lead Summit. Woo! For those of you who don't know me, I'm Jennifer Mnookin, and I have the great luck of being dean here at the UCLA School of Law. And I cannot tell you what a pleasure it is to be here with all of you today and to share in this milestone event, which lots of us have been looking forward to for quite a while now. Today's summit will be the largest and most impressive gathering of female students and graduates in this law school's history. I think more than 400 people register today, and it's a terrific, extraordinary group. And it's days like today, I have to say that as dean, these are the days that make the job incredibly rewarding, fun, and meaningful. And they capture part of what this institution is about and why I cherish my connection to it, and I hope that all of you do too. So I just want to thank you for being here, for being part of the school, and for being here for one another and for this terrific day. So first of all, a big hand to all of you. Now, we also have some students here in the room with us. If you're a current UCLA student, will you raise your hand? Look at that. So thank you for being here on a rainy Friday, especially our second and third year. Sometimes try to avoid the Friday classes a little bit. So nobody's going to get much studying done in the library today, clearly. And so I really appreciate your enthusiastic participation. And also for those of you who are no longer students, I know that you're going to be eager and willing to connect with our students and talk to them about their dreams and hopes and help them take the next step on their professional journeys. I want to take just a couple of minutes before we get off to our real start to offer my very heartfelt thanks to all of our terrific co-sponsors, led by platinum sponsors Latham & Watkins and Paul Hastings, so let's give them a hand too. As well as the many other generous supporters listed in today's program. And there are three women that I absolutely need to thank. They made this day possible. They are our event co-chairs. And I really cannot say enough good things about these three extraordinary women who gave a huge amount of time, energy, and brilliant vision to make today possible. They are Nancy A. Bell. Nancy, I'm sorry, but I'm going to make you stand up. Just, there you go. Nancy's a 1979 graduate of the law school, and she's a partner at Paul Hastings here in Los Angeles, one of the nation's top employment attorneys. She's on my board of advisors, and she is just, she's extraordinary. I also want to thank Maggie Hernandez, who is standing right here. A 1985 graduate of UCLA Law and the founder of Hernández Ventures in Pasadena. She's a dynamic businesswoman, another trusted member of my board of advisors, and these two women are on my board of advisors, among others, but they are executors, they make things happen, they have great ideas, and I am so lucky to have them in my cabinet, so to speak. And then Kara Horowitz, where are you? There, all right. Kara's a 2001 grad, and I get to see her almost every day because she's here at the law school full time as the Andrew Sabin Family Foundation co-executive director of our fabulous Emmett Institute on Climate Change and the Environment. The Emmett Institute, by the way, yes, I'm going to do a little institutional bragging here, is ranked as a top five environmental law program here in the country. We actually think we should be number one or two, wouldn't you say, Kara? And that's partly thanks to the tremendous work that Kara and her other team members do. And she is also just a can-do, extraordinary person. And Nancy, Maggie, and Kara have really poured themselves into making this great day possible. So let's give them one more round of applause for bringing us all together. Now, when I was thinking about what I wanted to say in just a few brief remarks today, I did keep coming back to a couple of the themes that drive this summit, that drive UCLA Law Women Lead, and our law school as a whole. Access, excellence, and equality, community across generations, personal excellence and professional excellence. These are words that describe what we're aiming to do here, but they're also much more than words. They're motivators, they're touchstones, they're calls to action, they're sometimes challenges. And they are also part of what makes UCLA Law Women Lead such a tremendously special endeavor. LEAD began under the leadership of my predecessor, Dean Emerita Rachel Moran, who's on the East Coast and so can't be with us today. But she really was the person who created and founded LEAD just about 2 years ago. And the goal was to create a network where current and past students and alums could connect, share wisdom, and provide mentorship to each other. I mean, we might even say kind of an old girls network, so to speak. And through programs precisely like this, not always quite so many fabulous women in the same room, but that is truly awesome, the idea was to make LEAD into a valuable resource for UCLA women from all eras and all rungs on the professional ladder. And I think it's already become a truly important part of our whole alumni, the way alumni and alums engage with each other. And there are folks who have become dear friends through the LEAD network. There are job opportunities that have been created through the LEAD network. There are mentoring moments that have resulted from the LEAD network. And at the law school, I've gotten terrific ideas for things that we're going to do inside these walls as well as more broadly. So I'm so grateful that this institution, this fabric, this network exists. And goodness knows there are so many astounding female alums and female faculty associated with this school. Our first tenured female professor was named Barbara Brudno, and she just passed away this past December. She started at UCLA in 1968, nearly half a century ago. And for several years, she was the only woman on our full-time faculty. And I imagine that cannot have been easy. That had to be lonely and challenging in lots of ways. Today, we have 24 women who are either tenured or on the tenure track. I'm the third woman to be dean here at UCLA. We are the only top 20 law school to have had three female deans. And it's just not really even an issue here today. They are, and they're just worth mentioning, Susan Westerberg-Prager, the first UCLA law graduate to become a dean of the school, and one of the first female law school deans in the country, and then my predecessor, Rachel Moran, and now me. Year in and year out, our student body is about half women. In fact, last year's first year class was a little over half. This year's a smidgen under half. I'm not telling my admissions guy what to do on the score, but I'm a little happy when it's 51% or 52%, just saying. And our 6,431 female alums include litigators, transactional attorneys, scholars, judges, businesswomen, entrepreneurs, and leaders of all kinds. We have a number of UCLA law grads in the upper reaches of the judiciary. In fact, the bench of the Ninth Circuit currently includes five of our alums, a distinguished list that starts with Dorothy Wright Nelson, who in 1953 was one of our very first female graduates. She also was one of the very first female deans at a school across town that I don't, you know. I love Dorothy, but maybe not that school quite so much. Two of our Ninth Circuit judges, Judge Kim McLean Wardlaw and Judge Sandra Okuda, will both be with us today. And of course, that's just the tip of the iceberg. There's so many areas and fields where UCLA women are thriving, succeeding, and making a difference. And we only need to look around this room to know precisely that. And I feel tremendously proud of those successes of you. And I also know, and you also know, that our success is often owed to a long line of others, mentors, women, and men, who have reached out their hands to help. Because there's no question that women do still face substantial barriers to equality and success in the professional world. And I hope that organizations like LEAD, that the way that it creates opportunities for you to engage with us and one another, I hope that in a small way, LEAD can break down those barriers and enhance the opportunities for all of us and for the generations to come. Now, today's panels include some incredible leaders, some of the most incredible leaders of any gender that you'll ever encounter. We've got big law partners, we've got CEOs, physicians, jurists, civil rights innovators, general counsel, and more. And of course, we have the Chief Justice of the California Supreme Court, who I'll be sitting down with for a conversation in just an hour or two. We're going to get the day started in just a few moments with presentations by three change agents. But before I do that, I want to say that we've got more than 30 alums on the program today, which is pretty incredible. And we also have around 60 in-house counsel who are part of our experience today on the panel and in the audience. And I think both of those are just amazing statistics and something that we should all be incredibly proud of. I also just love seeing all the women here, all the women in this room. I think it's only gonna get more crowded over the course of the day. I hope you will each get to know people in this room that you didn't know before and make those connections matter in some way as you continue on your professional and personal path. But now we're gonna get started with our first panel, and we're going to have presentations from three change agents. Alexis Herman, who was the US Secretary of Labor under Bill Clinton, and who now advises business on diversifying the workplace. Sally Krawcheck, who's a national trailblazer in networking and investing for women. And Dr. Barbara Natterson-Horwitz, who's a leading professor of medicine here at UCLA. So I know this is going to be a diverse and extraordinary panel to think about how we're all change agents in various ways. I hope you'll face this day with the passion, optimism, and commitment that you bring to everything you do. And just thank you so much for being here, one and all. Have a really great day. I kind of don't even need to ask you to do that because I know that we all will. Thank you very much. I'm just gonna call up now Maggie Hernandez, who's going to introduce the next panel. So thank you, Maggie.
Good morning, and welcome again to the UCLA Law LEAD Inaugural Summit, 2017 Inaugural Summit. As you all know, LEAD stands for Leadership, Empowerment, Advancement, and Distinction in Law, Business, and Society. My name, as Jennifer just mentioned, is Maggie Paláu Hernández. I graduated from UCLA in 1985, yes, a long time ago. I'm a founding board member of UCLA Law Women LEAD. I'm also a member of the Board of Advisors and co-chair of the summit. Well, I am incredibly proud to be here today, as I have the wonderful honor of introducing you to a woman that I greatly admire. And I can tell you that I was jumping for joy over a year ago when I asked her to give the inaugural leadership address, and without hesitation, she said yes. But before I introduce you to the Honorable Alexis M. Herman, I'm going to tell you a little bit about her. She was born in Mobile, Alabama, and began her career working for Catholic Charities, helping young men and women who were just recently out of school get a job at the Pascagoula, Mississippi shipyard. At the age of 29, President Jimmy Carter appointed her director of the Women's Bureau, making her the youngest director in the history of the Labor Department. In 1992, she became the first African-American woman to serve as an assistant to the president as director of the White House Office of Public Liaison. And on May 1, 1997, Alexis M. Herman was sworn in as America's 23rd Secretary of Labor and the first African-American ever to lead the United States Department of Labor. During her tenure as a member of the president's cabinet, she also served as a member of the National Economic Council. As Secretary of Labor, she focused on a prepared workforce, a secure workforce, and quality workplaces. She consolidated the department's wide array of skills development programs into a simpler, more efficient system. She led the effort to institute a global child labor standard. She moved people from welfare to work with dignity. She also launched the most aggressive unemployment youth initiative since the 1970s. Under her tenure, unemployment reached a 30-year low. The nation experienced the safest workplace record in the history of the Department of Labor. Alexis Herman's actions as Secretary of Labor were a reflection of her understanding of the needs and challenges we faced in the workplace. Her father served as the first African American elected to any office in the Deep South in the 1940s, and he instilled in her a belief that she could create meaningful change. Secretary Herman has served the last five presidents before President Trump in some capacity, and has always remained committed to helping others. She co-chaired the Bush Clinton Katrina Fund. She was a member of the board of the Clinton Bush Haiti Fund. She served as a trustee of her alma mater, Xavier University of Louisiana. She served as vice chair and trustee for the National Urban League. She co-chaired the Bush Clinton Presidential Leadership Scholars Program. She is a member of the executive board of Delta Sigma Theta Sorority, and she is president of the Dorothy Heights Educational Foundation. Secretary Herman has also received more than 25 honorary doctorate degrees from major universities and colleges around the country. But Secretary Herman is also incredibly accomplished in the business world as well. She currently serves as chair and chief executive officer of New Ventures LLC. She also chairs the Toyota Diversity Advisory Board. She is lead director at Cummins Inc. And she is also a member of the board of directors of Entergy, MGM Resorts International, and the Coca-Cola Company. And as you all know, there are not that many women, particularly African-American women, serving on corporate boards today in the United States. So you can all see why I'm so incredibly proud to be here and to have her here today. Would you please all stand and join me in a huge round of applause for our inaugural leadership speaker, the inaugural Alexis Herman.
Well, Maggie.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Wow. Good morning. Good morning. Thank you very, very much. Thank you. Thank you so much. And Maggie, first of all, let me thank you for your kind words of introduction. I want you to know, Maggie, my mama would have appreciated everything you just said about me, but my daddy, bless his heart, he would have believed you. But really, more than thanking Maggie for her kind words of introduction this morning, I want to thank Maggie for her leadership. I want to thank her for her leadership, not simply for what she has done to help bring this magnificent conference into being, but for all of the leadership walks and leadership challenges that she has faced. I also thank Maggie for her friendship. You know, I love her great spirit. I love her passion. I love her commitment that moves and inspires all of us. And one of the great blessings that I have had as being a member of the MGM Resorts Board of Directors was getting to know both Maggie and Roland Hernández. Roland, thank you for being here this morning. You know, Roland is our lead director, and so that's extra pressure on me this morning. But I am so glad that I'm able to call Maggie and Roland my friend. Dean Jennifer, whose work I have long admired, and we go back a ways, because we don't use the term old friends anymore. We say now friends of long standing. But I am really glad to be back on the campus of UCLA. But I'm especially pleased to be here for this inaugural LEAD Summit. And my congratulations and my thanks to all of the organizers who helped make this day possible. And as I listen to our dean talk about the composition of the room and the program, I want to thank all of you for being here, for making the investment today, for giving of your time, for giving of your talent to what I know is going to be a history-making day. Now, for my role to kick us off this morning, I've been asked to start the day by talking about my own leadership journey. What are the lessons that I have learned? What are the challenges that propelled me forward? But having Maggie as my coach, of course, Maggie said to me, "Alexis, I want you to keep it real. I want you to give us some real takeaways, things that we can remember, and hopefully things that will call us to action." And so, Maggie, I want you to know that I listened. And so as I thought about what I would say today, I think that I would characterize my own leadership journey as one of breaking barriers, of one who really had to step out of her own comfort zone to do things that she has never done before, but always being conscious of what it means to leave a positive legacy behind for others. But what it took for me to break those barriers can be summed up in what I call the four R's. One, taking risk. Two, expanding my reach. Three, testing my own reality. And four, allowing myself time for rejuvenation. So for the few moments that we have, and I want somebody to give me a 5-minute heads up at the end, great, thank you. I want to talk about risk, reach, reality, and rejuvenation. Now when I talk about risk, I don't know if I can step here a little bit. You know, sometimes I feel podium locked. I'm gonna do this. That's better for me. But you know, whenever I talk about taking risk, I always like to share the story of when I first learned what it meant to take a risk. And in many ways, this first experience is what has helped to shape most of my choices in life. And those choices have been choices for me that I characterize a life of work that has been spent breaking barriers, but especially opening doors and expanding opportunities for women and for those who have been left out. For me, and Roland knows this story, I was 15 years old. I was a sophomore in high school in Mobile, Alabama. It was a Catholic high school, most pure heart of Mary. And I don't know how many of you were good Catholic girls in this room today. But I can tell you that for those of you who are Catholic, there is something in our religion that's called the annual May Day celebrations, where we get to crown the Blessed Virgin Mary. And there are different celebrations in different churches around the country. In Mobile, it was the only time that the black Catholic high schools, all the schools really, and the white schools came together for the annual May Day procession for the crowning of the Blessed Virgin Mary in the local stadium. And this had been a tradition that had gone on for many years. And as in the past, the day of that celebration, that Sunday, the Mobile Press Register, our local newspaper, carried the story of the celebration at Mobile's Hartwood Field, and it named, as it always did, the young woman who had the privilege of crowning the Blessed Virgin Mary that day and all of the other high school members who were going to be a part of her court. The only problem was that never, ever in the history of the Press Register writing that story did they ever list Heart of Mary as a high school. And of course, we never got to crown the Blessed Virgin Mary. I'm not sure what got into me that day, but I found myself cutting that article out of the newspaper. I slipped it into my navy blue uniform pocket, And I was determined that somehow, I was going to find a way to have a conversation with the bishop that night and ask him, why were we never included? I mean, I was going to talk about, you know, somehow I think a Jesus conversation that, you know, this is not how it should be. I wasn't really sure what I was going to say. I simply knew I was going to say it. And so I get there and I march in behind all of the white schools, which was the tradition. We took our seats high up in the bleachers and the ceremony proceeded. Midway through that ceremony, I asked my homeroom teacher if I could be excused, and so I told a little fib. I said that I had to go to the bathroom. And so I found my way down to the field area, you know, where the dugout is, where the football players, the baseball players go in and out. I decided I would park myself right by that entranceway so that when the bishop and all the priests and all the celebrants left the field, they would have to pass by me. And I would be able to simply step out and have my conversation with the bishop. It seemed at the time like a very logical plan. There was one problem. As I positioned myself, I noticed that there was this policeman that kept going back and forth, and he was patrolling the area. So as the bishop and the priest and all of the participants started to leave the field and make their way to the dugout, I lost my nerve. And I saw this door. And I said to myself, well, I will find another day, another way to have this conversation. And so I slipped into this door. And I waited. And all of a sudden, I heard all the rustle. And the door starts to open. Well, little did I know that I had entered the dressing room of the bishop and all of the priests. Now, some today might call that divine intervention. I didn't call it that then. There was this big table, probably as big as this platform, and it had a big white tablecloth on. So I immediately, when that door opened, I crawled right under that table. And there I stayed. But then all of a sudden, I see these white altar board tops hitting the floor. I see the sashes from the Monsignors hitting the floor. And I panicked. I didn't know what was worse. My purpose for being there to confront the bishop, or being in a room sinning full of naked priests. I decided I would not sin that day. And so I crawled out from under that table. And I looked up, dead silence in the room. One of the Monsignors who knew me said, Alexis Herman, what are you doing here? And I did what any good Catholic girl would do. I said, I am here to kiss the bishop's ring. And so I rushed over to where Bishop Tulin was sitting. I fell to my knees. I grabbed his hand. I kissed it. I kissed the ring. And then I reached in my uniform pocket, and I pulled out the article. And I just started sputtering. Do you think we are part of the Catholic school system in Mobile, Birmingham dies? Why don't we ever get to crown the Blessed Virgin Mary? I went on and on and on. And finally, one of the Monsignors, the bishop, of course, was turning beet red. He didn't answer me at all. One of the Monsignors grabbed me and said, Alexis, I think you have said enough. You will hear from us tomorrow. So I left. I walked through the door. I walked back to where my class was, because we always marched at the end of the line. This time it was a good thing, because I was simply able to fall right in and march right out. But I got to school the next morning. And of course, as soon as I walked into my homeroom class, my name was beaming over the loudspeaker. Alexis Herman, report right away to the principal's office. Well, I knew what that was about. And so with tears in my eyes, I go to the principal's office, and there's Sister Dismas, a Dominican. She was just enraged. And she says, tell me you did not embarrass us this way. Tell me you did not do what they are telling me you did. And I said, I did. She said to me, go and get your books. You are expelled from this school. You are not worthy of being called a student of Most Pure Heart of Mary. And that was a tough blow for me. I was a pretty good student. And to be expelled and to be embarrassed. So I left. I went back to my homeroom. And there was my homeroom teacher, Sister Alberta. And with tears in her eyes, she put her arms around me. And she said to me, Alexis, you did the right thing. And so I went home that day, and the rest is really history, because what happened as a result of my being expelled, my parents were so enraged, and the other parents were so enraged, that they pulled all of their kids out of school. And so for the first time ever in the Mobile-Birmingham Diocese, we were able to sit down and have the conversations and the negotiations that ultimately led to the desegregation of the Catholic school system in our diocese. And the next year, we had someone in that procession. But I tell you that story because you see, I learned two invaluable lessons. The first was that I had a teacher who gave me positive reinforcement at a very critical moment in my life when she said to me, Alexis, you did the right thing. But secondly, I learned that it is not so much about the individual risks that we take in life. It is about the habit of getting into risk taking. It is about developing that habit. And the more you do it, the more the butterflies diminish in your stomach, and the more the fear that oftentimes grips us, it becomes diminished. And we learn to relieve our stress. And that has to do with whether you're making a tough decision or whether you're working on some big project. The reality is, it is so important for us, I believe, to get into the habit of risk-taking if we're really going to move forward and to propel ourselves in life. Now my second lesson, expanding my reach. I was fortunate to have much of my early life guided by three incredible people. And when I talk about expanding my reach, I did it through three very unconventional relationships. I call them my foundational mentors, because you see, we never outgrow our need for sponsors and for authentic relationships that propel us on. My first foundational relationship was Rosemary Winder, a Catholic nun who gave me my first job at Catholic Charities in Mobile, Alabama. There I was a traditional caseworker, social worker, with a traditional portfolio. But I quickly learned that I could not make a difference in the families, in the children, in the Roger Williams Housing Project by doing the traditional casework that I was assigned to do. Because I knew that this was a community that needed jobs. They needed economic empowerment. And that was going to be the only way to get these kids off the street. The problem was, there wasn't anyone really hiring at that time in Mobile. The only jobs were really in the nearby shipyards in Pascagoula, Mississippi, about 40 minutes away from Mobile. So I found myself finding out what were the jobs in the skilled trades, in the apprenticeship area, things that these young kids could perhaps learn about and find new opportunities. And so, because of Rosemary's support, and the flexibility that she gave me to do my job, I immersed myself in the testing and learning all about the skilled trades. I knew nothing about the labor movement. I knew nothing about shipyards. But I was determined to help these kids figure it out, pass the tests, and to break through the barriers that was holding them back. And so, after a lot of work and a lot of support, I'm very proud to say that 2 years later, we really were able to get the first African-American young males ever into the building trades in the Deep South. They got in as painters and boilermakers, electricians, and sheet metal workers. A whole new world opened up for them. But I was only able to do that because I had the support and the confidence of that first supervisor who allowed me to create, to innovate, who embraced my pioneering spirit to let me forge a new path and a new way. It was Rosemary who first helped me to help my light shine. And I say that especially to the young women. And I say that to first-time hirees, to supervisors. Be conscious of the impact that you have on your law firms and your jobs and your work on those first-time relationships. They really do make a difference. My second mentor was Ray Marshall. Ray Marshall went on to become Jimmy Carter's Secretary of Labor. When I met Ray, he was head of the School of Economics at the University of Texas. I don't know if we have anyone here from Austin today. But Ray, hi there. Ray at the time had heard about my work in the shipyards in Pascagoula. And so he came to see me, to interview me, to talk to me, to ask me how had I done it. He wanted to write it up. And it was Ray Marshall who encouraged me to move to Atlanta, Georgia, and to try some of the same techniques and experiences, but this time with women, and to help women for the first time break the corporate barriers in corporate America in the Deep South. And because of Ray's support and a generous grant from the Ford Foundation, I was able to help get the first women into managerial professional jobs, white collar jobs, in major corporations in the Deep South. First accountant at Delta Airline, the first professional at Coca-Cola, and the list goes on. But the fact of the matter is, had it not been for Ray's support and encouragement, it would not have happened. Now, I tell you the story about Ray Marshall because you see, Ray Marshall was the first white male that I had ever had a relationship with. It was Ray Marshall who helped me to overcome my own racial and cultural barriers. Ray let me into his space, he let me into his world, and I was able to have authentic conversations. You know, for me, growing up in the Deep South, probably the only real relationship that I'd ever had with a white male, Roland, was with my Catholic priest, and that was in the confessional saying, "Bless me, Father, for I have sinned." But Ray was someone who got to know my family, I got to know his, and he has literally been in my life from that day to this day. He was there for me as Secretary of Labor, and now we're in real role reversal, as he is now in his retirement years in Austin, Texas. My third foundational relationship was Dorothy Irene Height. Now, some of you may not have heard of Dorothy Height, but Dorothy Height was the founder and president for more than 50 years of the National Council of Negro Women. She died in 2010 at the age of 98. And while Rosa Parks was called the mother of the movement, Dorothy Height was called the godmother of the civil rights movement. She was the only woman in the so-called Big Six of men in the leadership movement. And while we all today remember that famous March on Washington in 1963, there was no woman speaker. Dorothy Height was the only woman designated to speak that day. But she gave up her spot for a young John Lewis because she said she thought it was important for the voices of young people to be heard. And so it was from Dorothy that I learned what it meant to still hold your head high, to stand tall and to have that confidence when you might be the only woman, or sometimes the only African American in the room. You know, she taught me how to may like and play like, you know, and not to let them see me sweat, which sometimes I really did. But she instilled in me a confidence and a courage that really stayed with me all of my life. On Wednesday, Maggie knows this, one of the reasons it was tough for me getting here was that the post office unveiled the first forever stamped, and Dorothy Height is on it for the year 2017. Yes. You should Google it. It was a marvelous ceremony. It's called Dorothy Height Forever Stamp. But now she joins the heroes and the sheroes, and her legacy will live on as a part of the Postal Service's stamp collection. The reality is, we need remarkable great women in our lives, like Dr. Height. It was Dr. Height who really encouraged me to be clear about my own strengths and my own weaknesses. It was Dorothy Height who encouraged me and kept pushing me to keep testing my own reality and to expand my own horizons, to raise my own threshold for the unfamiliar, and to do that through relationships and through people and through different experiences in our lives. And when I talk about this notion of testing our own reality, you really do have to get out of your own head and push your own refresh buttons to be clear about what it is you need to do to keep growing and to keep learning. And because I'm talking to a large group of women lawyers, I want to tell you about my first real experience in testing my own reality and in testing my own assumptions. Some of you may remember this case. Jennifer, I know you do. But when I first moved to Washington, D.C. as the director of the Women's Bureau, the very first policy position that I had to work on involved amending Title VII of the Civil Rights Act to say that discrimination based on pregnancy constituted a form of sex discrimination. That was 1978. Because you see, in this country, we had no policy governing pregnancy leave. A woman could not be pregnant and be guaranteed of her job rights when she came back. And she had to use sick leave and vacation leave if she was going to have a baby. And the case was tested in a Supreme Court case involving the General Electric Company and the IBEW. And in this case, the IUE, I'm sorry, the electrical workers. And in this case, you see, the General Electric Company was giving a man 6 weeks off to have a hair transplant. True story. But it wouldn't give a woman 6 weeks off to have a baby as a part of its disability policy. Well, after I got past treating pregnancy as a disability, and had to get with the rigors of the law to say that, you know, a woman should be able to have 6 weeks off with guaranteed job rights the same way that a man can under the disability policies. Well, in this case, the woman lost. She lost because the Supreme Court actually ruled that discrimination based on pregnancy was not a form of sex discrimination. And the Supreme Court actually went on to rule that it could see no clear relationship between pregnancy and sex. Well, neophyte that I was all the way from Mobile, Alabama, I knew that there was a clear relationship between pregnancy and sex. But I have never ceased to be amazed that it actually took the enactment of legislation, the amending of Title VII of the Civil Rights Act, to say yes, discrimination based on pregnancy constitutes a form of sex discrimination. And that is how today now we have all of the laws and support that governs pregnancy leave in this country. But I tell you that story because I learned two lessons from that in testing my own reality. One, you know, common sense is not so common in the nation's capital. But secondly, you really have to enroll people, educate people to your point of view. Just because you believe it's right, just because you think it's the right thing to do, doesn't necessarily mean everybody else gets it. And so you really have to stay at it. That's why this conference is so very important. The things that you are doing here, the networks, the relationships that you are forming. We need to do the homework to study the issues and to be clear about the education and the enrollment that still needs to take place. And when you know that two-thirds of the labor market expansion today is comprised of women, we've got to do a lot more to support that engagement. Back then, it was all about everybody asking, why are all of these women coming into the workforce? But today we are here, and we need to figure out the new paradigms, the new ways of support and encouragement that will make a difference for women. I love having the conversation with Maggie when she said, for instance, just in the field of law, that we need a new paradigm for how women progress and become law partners. It can't just be about billable hours, given all of the multiple roles that women have to play. And the talent and the strength and the energy and the vision that is in this room, you are the ones who can help bring about that kind of change. And lastly, I want to talk to you about my fourth R, rejuvenation. I had to find a way to allow myself the time to rejuvenate, to create balance in my life. My grandmother used to always say to me, Alexis, you're always fixing and doing. And so for me, I had to figure out, how do I create that balance? It became a part of my DNA and a part of my plan, my scheduling, my habit. I schedule playtime. I schedule family time, just the same way I schedule work time. Because I know if I don't put it on the calendar, someone is going to use that time up. And I am just as protective of that as I would be a meeting with the President of the United States. I had to learn to take care of my body, to fortify myself, to eat the right foods, to drink water, to get my rest. I had to learn to stop taking my briefs and my papers to bed with me. Because you see, all of that physical stress really does affect our mental state. And face it, we as women are still the primary nurturers, and we're still the primary caregivers for our families and oftentimes at work. And so we have to know the importance of what it means to take care of ourselves, to fortify ourselves, so that we can do the work that we need to do today and into the future. I have been so blessed to have had my faith that guides me and sustains me, my family that supports me, but my friends who bolster me, a wonderful array of women who have helped make the difference in my life. And so as I close and as I get the 5-minute sign, I did have a closing, and I'm going to see if I can find it. I wanted to close by saying that you have so much to look forward to, I think, today. You've got very practical workshops. You have a wonderful panel with very rich discussions, talking about the role of women, women in leadership. And I believe, especially now, with a new administration, that the role of women will become even more important. And so I encourage you to stay involved and to stay engaged. We need you. You know, leadership is not a position or something that you chase after. I believe that Leaders are shaped and not born. And they are shaped by events, circumstances, and the people in their lives. And I believe that we all have the capacity to lead. But what is missing, and I say this especially to the students and the young women who are here, what is missing are women today who are willing to step into that gap and being able to make a difference in whatever the situation calls. And so I close now. And I leave you with the words of that great suffragette, Elizabeth Cady Stanton, the great leader of the suffragette movement, who really helped women to get the right to vote. Elizabeth said as a part of that fight that if in being human and therefore emotional, the struggle for equality gets to you every now and then, fear not. The queens in history compare favorably with the kings. Thank you, and God bless you today. Thank you.